Thursdays at 7 p.m. starting on January 4th in the sanctuary. Sign up at ccbeaumont.org under events. We are excited to announce that on Sunday, January 7th, we're going to be having a baptism following the third service. This is a great way to follow in the footsteps of Jesus and publicly proclaim your faith in him. Please sign up on the events page at ccbeaumont.org. And if you've already been baptized, come and support your brothers and sisters.
Are you new to Jesus, or have you been walking in him for many years? We're pleased to announce a class for everyone, CCB's Foundations in the Faith. This class is going to be starting on Sunday, January 14th at 8 a.m. and on Monday, January 15th at 6:30 p.m. in room number 5. In this class, you're going to learn about the Holy Spirit, salvation, prayer, and many more topics on the Christian faith. So sign up today at ccbeaumont.org under events.
Attention ladies, join the women of Calvary Chapel Beaumont as they continue their study Experiencing God on January 9th at 9 a.m. or 6:30 p.m. In this study, you will be walking through the Bible to understand how to live a God-centered way of life that causes you to join God in his work. You will also meet for worship and teaching and time in small groups. In these groups, you will discuss what you learned about God, what you learned about yourself, and how you can apply the scriptures to your life. Childcare is available in the morning session.
Wives, do you want to reflect God's love and light in your marriage? Consider taking 10 weeks to focus on God's gift of marriage. The Bible study, Reflecting God's Love in Marriage, A Call to Wives, begins on January 15th at 6:30 p.m. Registration is limited, so sign up early at ccbeaumont.org under events.
Church family, if you've experienced a major loss through the death of a loved one, Grief Share can assist you in the process of healing. Grief Share is a 14-week program where you can share your journey through grief with others who have experienced similar losses. During these biblically-based meetings, you will learn to understand your grief experience while exploring ways to grow emotionally and grow spiritually through the process. This group covers a variety of topics related to loss, including, is this normal? The challenges of grief, the journey of grief, grief and your relationships. Grief Share begins on February 5th at 6 o'clock p.m. Sign up at ccbeaumont.org under events.
Church family, we would love to pray for you. If you need prayer for anything, you can fill out a prayer request card in the sanctuary, or you can email prayer@ccbeaumont.org. And even if you can't come to the sanctuary, you can also join the prayer team on Wednesday mornings at 8 a.m. in the sanctuary. You can also pray throughout the week for each request by using the Church Center app. See, through the app, you can sign up for the prayer group, receive the weekly prayer requests, and even send your own requests to the rest of the group. It's a great way to keep connected with your church family. We hope you love to worship the Lord. See, to worship the Lord with your tithes and offerings, you can drop them in the offering boxes on the sides of the media booth, or you can visit ccbeaumont.org and click the Give tab to give online. You can also mail them to the church office. So as we get ready to worship, please check your cell phone and make sure it's silent. This will help us cut down on any distractions.
Remember to preach the gospel and love one another.
Yes, Father, help us. Help us, Lord, to preach the gospel and love one another. Help us to do that. Lord, this is the last day of 2023, but we get a whole new year, Lord, if you wait through the end of it. Lord, to give us opportunities to share you with others, Father. Help us to do that. Father, help our hearts be ready today to hear your word from Pastor Vince, Father. Get us ready, Lord. Get us ready. Lord, we just ask you to bless all those online as well. And Pastor Henry and Shondell, as they're away today, we give you thanks for this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, why don't you stand with us?
From the African plain. Oh, it's the song of the forgiven, drowning out the Amazon rain. Song, the song of Asian believers, filled with God's holy fire. It's every tribe, every tongue, every nation, love song born of a grateful choir. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns, he reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns, he reigns. So let it rise above the four winds, caught up in the heavenly sound. Let praises echo from the towers of cathedrals to the faithful gathered underground. Of all the songs sung from the dawn of creation, some were meant to persist. Of all the bells rung from a thousand steeples, none rings truer than this. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns, he reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns.
It's all God's people sing.
It's all God's people singing glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns, he reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns, he reigns. And all the powers of darkness tremble at what they've just heard. 'Cause all the powers of darkness can't drown out a single word. When all God's children sing out glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns, he reigns. When all God's people sing out glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns, he reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns, he reigns. It's all God's people singing glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns, he reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns, he reigns. It's all God's people singing glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns.
Amen. Amen. Well, why don't you greet some of those people that are around you?
We sing to the God who heals. We sing to the God who heals. from that grave. My God, still rolling stones away.
There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise.
We were the beggars. Now we're royalty. We were the prisoners. Now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by His grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise.
We were the beggars. Now we're royalty. We were the prisoners. Now we're running free. We were forgiven, accepted, redeemed by His grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in His place. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. We shout out your praise. Yeah. We shout out your praise.
A shout. Hallelujah, Lord. Praise to Jesus. Amen. Glory to you, Lord.
We do. Do you feel the shadows deepen? We do. Do you know that all the dark won't stop the light from getting through? We do. You wish that you could see it all made through. Is all creation groaning?
It is.
Is a new creation coming?
It is.
Is the glory of the Lord to be the light within our midst?
It is.
Could we remind ourselves of this?
It is.
Is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave. He is David's root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slave. Is he worthy? Is he worthy of all blessing and honor and glory? Is he worthy?
Father truly love us?
He does.
Is the Spirit move among us?
He does.
And does Jesus our Messiah hold forever those he loves?
He does.
Does our God intend to dwell again with us?
He does.
Is anyone worthy?
Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll?
The lion
of Judah, he conquered the grave. He is David's root and the lamb who died to ransom the slave.
From every people and tribe, every nation and tongue, he has made us a kingdom of priests to God, to reign with his Son. Is he worthy? Is he worthy of all blessing and honor and glory? Is he worthy? Is he worthy? Is he worthy?
God's word is a book of promises. Thank you, Jesus.
God of Abraham, the God of covenant, faithful promises. Time and time again, you have proven, do just what you say. Though the storms may come and the winds may blow, I'll remain steadfast and let my heart learn every single word comes to pass.
Great is your faithfulness to me. Great is your faithfulness to me.
God, from age to age, though the earth may pass away, the word remains the same, yeah. History can prove there's nothing you can't do, faithful and true. Though the storms may come and the winds may blow, I'll remain steadfast and let my heart learn every single word will come to your faithfulness to me. Great is your faithfulness to me. From the rising sun to the setting sun, I will praise your name. Great is your faithfulness to me. Put my faith in Jesus, my anchor to the ground, my hope and firm foundation. He'll never let me down. I put my faith in Jesus, my anchor.
bless you.
When I'm in the middle of the road and I don't know which way to go,
I'll still bless you.
I've got a reason to bless your name. You've been faithful. You've been faithful.
I'll still bless you.
I will bless your name.
I will bless your name.
Great is your faithfulness.
Great is your faithfulness to me. Great is your faithfulness to me.
From the rising sun,
from the rising sun to the setting same, I will praise your name. Great is your faithfulness to me.
Thank you, Lord. Great is your faithfulness. Amen. Let's pray. So, Father in heaven, we thank you for this beautiful day. Thank you for these smiley faces who've come here to hear your word. Lord, we love you. We praise you because you're worthy to be praised. You are so faithful to us. You keep all of your promises. You're worthy to be praised. You show us just how good you are. And may that reflect in our own faces, in our own lives. Thank you for the cross of Jesus Christ, for the blood that was shed, and for the mercy you show us through that. That each person here and online can come to salvation in Jesus, we thank you. We thank you for every blessing in our lives, for our families, for our friends, for the church family. May you continue to work in each person here, drawing us closer and closer to you. May we know you and know you well. Father, I ask that you would speak through me today, that I'd rightly divide your word, that you'd be honored and glorified through what is said. Thank you for the worship, for receiving it, for receiving our prayers. May it all be a sweet aroma unto you. Lord, we love you, we praise you, and it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Have a seat. Well, welcome to the last day of the year. You made it. How's everybody doing? How was Christmas?
Blessed.
Good. Lots of goodies and presents. Half of you have gym memberships now, right? It's okay. A few things going on, a few announcements going on. Tonight at 5 o'clock, tonight at 5 o'clock, we're having a prayer meeting from 5 to 6. I know it's New Year's Eve. I know you're all going to bed at 6:30, but come on out at 5. We'll pray for an hour, and then you can go home, go take a nap, unless you're staying up. Who's staying up late? 10 people. That's 8 more than first service. God bless you. We have a few announcements besides the prayer meeting tonight at 5 in the sanctuary. The men's ministry is starting their study in Hebrews. It's called The Supremacy of Jesus. It's this Thursday at 7 p.m. You can sign up online at ccbeaumont.org under events. We also have a women's study restarts on the 9th, Tuesday the 9th at 9 a.m. and 6:30 p.m. But there's also a new women's study starting Monday the 8th. And it's called Reflecting God's Love in Marriage. And it's a beautiful time for a lady to see what it means to be a wife, that the marriage might flourish even more. So please sign up for that. That's on Monday nights. And then, of course, next week is baptism. Praise the Lord. It's not today. It's a little chilly. The water will be warm. Your hearts will be filled. If you've not been baptized and you're a follower of Jesus, sign up online. If you forget, show up anyways. It's after third service. Pastor Henry will submerge you, you'll come up, and you'll proclaim what Jesus has done in here to the world. Amen? Amen? And if you've been baptized, it's okay to come and support your fellow brothers and sisters in Christ. Amen? Amen? Amen. Well, today we are in the book of Matthew, Matthew 24. We have a topical, it is the last day of the year, looking forward to next year. And the title of today's message is Your Future in Christ, Your Future in Christ, Matthew 24. Give me an amen when you're there. Now, when I start out, I like to make a very controversial statement. Are you ready? You ready?
I was born late 1967. That's very controversial. Some of you think I'm 35. I'm not. My son's almost 30. Some of you think I'm 85. I'm not, but I feel like it sometimes. But it's amazing what happens over the years. You think you're one thing, and then it transforms. It's like, wow, where'd all these years go? Some of you think I'm just a puppy. I'm not even 60 yet. I wish I was in my 50s, some of you are thinking. I miss my 40s. When my parents turned 40, I thought they were ancient. And now I'm way past that. Growing up in the 70s and 80s, we were young and wild and free, according to the musical poet Bryan Adams. Some of you got that. That means you're my age. Growing up back in the day as a kid, from my perspective, excuse me, the future looked bright. I could play all day, ride my bike out in the streets, miles from home, till the street lights came on. We had family meals every night. Imagine that. I dreamt of a future of success in just about every major league sport. Accomplished none of it. I was going to be young forever. As the years progressed, I was looking forward to driving someday, falling in love, getting married, having a few little munchkins myself, and repeating the good times and good life I grew up experiencing. Our family had a station wagon. Anybody? A white picket fence, literally. A dog, loving parents. We went to a church every Sunday. They tried. Wasn't the right kind, but we did. And we lived in the great old U.S. of A., so you know we must be Christians. Russia was the enemy. The president was revered. The Dodgers were going to win every World Series starting next year. And the American dream was our hope. We had it all. What could be better? The future was certain. But God. In 1997, God got a hold of this. At the dinner table of a co-worker of mine, we weren't really friends, we knew each other. He proclaimed the gospel to me. I'd never heard about grace before. I came to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. And because of that guy, I see him once every other year, and it's like we just saw each other yesterday. And it's this great kinship that we have. And it's my future changed forever. That one moment. We grew up religious, but actually it was grace. The Lord abounds in grace and mercy. And that's why I stand here today. I never imagined standing in front of people talking about the Lord, ever. Ever. Now maybe you grew up under similar circumstances. Maybe your upbringing was radically different. Maybe you lived in the inner city, didn't have a dad in the family. Maybe you were affluent and you went to every college there was and got every degree there was. Maybe you're blue collar. Maybe you're white collar. Maybe you have no collar. I don't know. Maybe you're a stay-at-home mom, which is the toughest job there is, moms. That's why the guys go to work, because we don't want that job. That's hard. But whatever your upbringing is, here's a statement for everybody today. Hi, online, by the way. Good morning. You can revolutionize your future today by receiving Jesus Christ as your Savior. Amen. You can revolutionize your eternal life forever and ever by making Jesus Christ your Savior today. Online too, or outside. Many of you know him, but not everybody does. But you can do that today. So this message is for you, if you don't know Jesus. Now, X amount of you just turned off your brains. Well, I know Jesus, so I don't have to listen. No, this message is for you too. Because the Holy Spirit wants to revolutionize your heart and mind in Jesus Christ and motivate you to love and serve him more this next year. More. Because you want to, not because we're twisting your arms. All those announcements I made, I hope we never make another announcement. Because everyone's just going there because everybody wants to do stuff. It's like, oh no, there's too many. That's okay. We'll figure it out. We'll figure it out. After this message, you're going to have the opportunity to come to saving knowledge of Jesus Christ or draw closer to him or just praise him because you're close to him. And we're going to have some people praying on the sides, and I tell you that now because I'll forget later. they want to pray with you. So don't tune things out. God has something for all of us today. So here we are in Matthew 24, and leading up to chapter 24 is this scene where Jesus is in the temple, and he declares all of these woes to the scribes and Pharisees. These woes are a declaration against the religious leaders' hypocrisy. These religious leaders had an ungodly heart attitude and manner of leading the Jewish nation. They're in charge and not really following God themselves. Jesus proclaims how the scribes and Pharisees have shut up the kingdom of heaven, devoured widows' houses, made false followers of God, that they put their trust in the temple and its gold. These religious leaders might tithe of mint and cumin, but fail to show justice, mercy, and faith. Jesus rebukes them as a brood of vipers, a bunch of snakes, exclaiming that they might be clean on the outside, but on the inside they were dirty. In verse 37 of chapter 23, Jesus says this, "O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, the one who kills the prophets and stones those who are sent to her, how often I wanted to gather your children together as a hen gathers her chicks under her wings, but you were not willing." Jesus wants to gather us too. "See, your house has left you desolate. For I say to you, you shall see me no more till you say, 'Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.'" In a short time, Jesus will fulfill this prophecy, entering Jerusalem, riding a donkey on Palm Sunday, and the people will proclaim, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." How quickly they'll change by the end of the week. We got to go to Israel earlier in the year. We got to see the exact gate he went through. And the Muslims made the Jews block it up so that the Messiah can't go through it. He already did. But he'd do it anyways, even if it was blocked up. This proclamation comes, and it's going to lead to his arrest and ultimately his crucifixion. But Jesus knows their hearts. Point number one, Jesus knows your heart. Jesus knows your heart and mine. Jesus desired that that Israel as a nation would come and receive him, but they were blind to who he was and why he was there. His heart is sorrowful over their rejection of him, and he still loves them, and he knows their future. Jesus desires that you and I would come and receive him if you have not, that you would no longer be blind to who he is and why he came to earth. His heart is sorrowful over us if we're rejecting him, and he knows our future. If you haven't prioritized Jesus in your life, today is the day to make things right with him. Make things right with him today. Pastor Henry taught a couple weeks ago, the prodigal son left, spent all the money, comes back. Did the father say, "Go away"? No, he's happy to see him. Wherever you stand with Jesus Christ today, he's happy to receive you back if you have drifted from him. Did you know that most of the world rejects Jesus today? Most of the world rejects Jesus today. Have you been rejecting him? Have you pushed him aside? Is he not so important anymore? Well, why? Whatever the reason, why? Why not come back? Why not call out to him today and return to your first love if you've drifted away? Matthew 24, let's go to verse 1. "Then Jesus went out and departed from the temple, and his disciples came up to show him the buildings of the temple. And Jesus said to them, 'Do you not see all these things? Surely I say to you that not one stone shall be left here upon another that shall not be thrown down.' Now as he sat on the Mount of Olives, the disciples came to him privately saying, 'Tell us, when will these things be, and what will be the sign of your coming and of the end of the age?'" We're still asking those questions today. It's a little hotter in the news right now. I have pastor friends who say we are in the last days. Could be. Very close. We're approaching, for sure. "And Jesus answered and said to them, 'Take heed that no one deceives you. For many will come in my name, saying, I am the Christ, and will deceive many. And you will hear will hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that you are not troubled, for all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. For nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom, and there will be famines and pestilences and earthquakes in various places. All these are the beginning of sorrows. Then they will deliver you up to tribulation and kill you, and you will be hated by all nations for my name's sake. And then many will be offended, will betray one another, and will hate one another. Then many false prophets will rise up and deceive many. And because lawlessness will abound, the love of many will grow cold. But he who endures to the end shall be saved. And this gospel of the kingdom will be preached in all the world as a witness to all the nations, and then the end will come. Ooh. So we're talking about the last days here. Ooh. First of all, Jesus comes in, and they arrive in the temple, and he says, Do you not see all these things? Assuredly, I say to you that not one stone shall be left here upon another that shall not be thrown down. Point number one was Jesus knows your heart. Point number two, Jesus knows your future. And the temple he's talking about, we'll show a few pictures here. The first one is, there's the Wailing Wall, the Western Wall. We got to see that. Beautiful, beautiful sight. There's the Dome of the Rock, which is the Muslim Dome of the Rock. It's not Jewish or Christian. These are the kind of stones that are in that wall. And this is just the foundation stones of where the temple used to be. Go to the next one. There's the Wailing Wall again. There's a ramp up there so you can go up top to where the temple would be. Next slide. And there's a representation of what the temple looked like. I think it's 60 cubits by 20 cubits by 30 cubits, so like 90, 30, 45, something like that, feet. Just the tall part. So it's this massive looking structure made of these heavy blocks, and some of these blocks were hundreds of tons. We saw some in the wall. They were hundreds and hundreds of tons. For the Jews, the temple is many things. It's a massive structure, a holy site, the place to have animals sacrificed. You could have your sins covered by the blood of that animal once a year. How sad is that? We can go to Jesus at any moment. It's an important place that is revered. Even today, there's the Temple Institute, and they're raising cattle to sacrifice. They've made all the forks and the things they use, the utensils they use. They're making the fires. They're making the menorah. They're making the things the priests wear, getting ready for the temple to be rebuilt. But Jesus makes this astounding statement that one day the most important Jewish site will be destroyed, and this is unthinkable to the Jews. How could this be? This is it. To the religious leaders, the temple was what they swore by and what they based their lives upon, but they no longer trusted in God. They trusted in the temple and its gold. Is there something that we might be trusting in more than God? Is it our temple? I mean, our home? Is it our gold? Our bank account? Our retirement account? Social Security? Is it our job? Is it our mode of transportation? Is it our kids or our grandkids? Are we trusting in something more than the Lord? Now, all these things can be enjoyed and should be, but not more than our enjoyment of the Lord. He should be number one. After all, he gave us all these things and those relationships as a gift to enjoy, not to take place of him. It's like when I paid for my kids' phones and they're on the couch on their phones, like, hey, pay attention to Dad. I didn't give you your phone to ignore me. And then when I would call, it's like, hey, if you're not going to pick up, why do you need a phone? Pay attention. I want that relationship. I'm guilty too, so. Imagine the religious leader's whole world being shattered in AD 70 when the Romans surround the city, starve out the people, tear down the temple, pushing it one block at a time. There's a couple ways that it possibly came down. Someone shot a fiery arrow through it, caught fire, and the gold that was in the temple melted into the blocks, and so that caused the Roman soldiers to push it over to get the gold back. But it also, you know, it would demoralize the Jews that their most precious site is gone, pushed down. God allows this to happen. Why? Basically, because they're rejecting him. They rejected his son. They didn't come to him. Jesus is talking about them coming as the chicks come to a hen, because he wants to gather them, but yet they didn't know who he was or why he was there. Imagine if every Christian church building was taken away today. What would happen to your faith in Christ? Hopefully nothing, maybe even strengthen it. It's a building. We're hopeful to build two more, not to say we have two more buildings, but you see the space, or lack thereof. We want new friends coming. We want to minister to more hearts. And I'm not saying me and Pastor Henry and Pastor Jim or Pastor William. We're saying we want everybody ministering to everybody. That's our calling. That's our calling. We're here to equip you, and you guys are go and do. Now, just because we're in a building, I'm not saying don't come. The earth is God's footstool, so what's a building? I want you to feel at home here. But make sure you prioritize your walk in Christ over any other thing. Part of our walk in Christ is to be obedient to Jesus. Correct? Amen. Correct? Yes. All right, good. Be obedient to Jesus, good. Part of that is loving one another, correct?
Yes.
Two for two, good. Here's a big one. Loving one another includes ministering to others.
Yes.
Even when they irritate you.
Yes.
If we only minister to the non-irritating people, we'd be pretty lonely because we irritate people. And also, we're not here to be some sort of Christian hermit. To come to church, to go home, come late, leave early, grab a donut on your way out, and not talk to anybody. That's unbiblical. My daughter dreamed of living in Alaska with a bunch of animals and no people. I understand. But then I say, well, it's kind of hard to share the gospel to animals and no people. People need Jesus. The animals are just a gift. Jesus not only knows the future of the temple, which has already happened, it was destroyed. That caused the nation to disperse, to run away from Israel. They weren't a nation for 1900 years until 1948, which has never happened before in the history of history. History just hasn't happened. My grandmother was Italian, full-blooded. She could yell and cook at the same time. She's this tall and you're afraid of her. My mom's part Italian, I'm even less. And just that in three generations, that's kind of fading away. But for the Jewish nation, 1900 years and they're back? It says something about that here, and it's happening. Jesus knows the future of the temple. When he proclaims these things, he knows your future and mine, and this is our future for the believer. If you know Jesus, this is your future, from John 14. It's Jesus speaking, "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you." So believer, he's preparing a place for you right now. We use this caption, these verses at memorials frequently, as a reminder. As a reminder. And it says, "If I go prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And where I go, you know, and the way you know." This is going to happen, folks. If you're a believer, Jesus is going to take you to that place someday. And it may be very soon for some of us. Yes. This year, we had the privilege of doing an onslaught of memorials. Some good friends from this fellowship. People we loved, people you never expected. They get news and 2-3 months later, they're in heaven. And you're going, "Oh my goodness, Lord. Thank you for keeping your promises. Promise of eternal life." And so you cry, but then again, it's like, all right, this is what's going to happen for every believer. Unless you're raptured. There's joy. Thank you. So he's going to come. He's going to return for the believer. And where I go, you know the way, you know, he says. And Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? And Jesus said, of course, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except through me. Zeroes in on exactly how we get to the Father, through Jesus Christ and him alone. This wonderful promise of the future is for every believer in Christ. He's going to take you to that place. He's preparing now, and that is so beautiful. Can't wait. I can't wait. Now, it doesn't mean we sit on the couch. Is it today, Lord? No, we have stuff to do, okay? A wonderful future is not promised to the non-believer. Did you know that? Jesus is not returning for the non-believer to take them to his Father's house. When the non-believer perishes, they go to the great white throne judgment. This is Revelation 20, if you'd like to turn there. Revelation 20, and these verses make me sad, but it's truth. It's truth. Not everybody goes to heaven. If everybody went to heaven, there'd be no need for the cross. But Jesus is going to take those who love him. Revelation 20, verse 11. Then I saw a great white throne and him who sat on it, from whose face the earth and heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, standing before God, and books were opened. And another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged according to their works by the things which were written in the books. How would you like to be judged according to your works? Your works are like filthy rags. An oil rag is cleaner than your filthy rags. It just is. We have nothing to offer God. But when he fills us with his Spirit, he can use us. The sea gave up the dead who were in it, and death and Hades delivered up the dead who were in them. And they were judged, each one according to his works. Then death and Hades were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. The first one is physical. The second one is spiritual. Here's the saddest line in the Bible. And anyone not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. People we know are going to be cast into the lake of fire. We need to get busy, family. Proclaim Jesus to those who are lost, that they might come to salvation in him, and that that lake might not be filled up. But again, most of the world rejects him. We need him desperately. We need him desperately. So Jesus knows our future. So what is your future, family? What is your future? Do you trust in him or not? It's one or the other. You can't sit in the middle and say, well, I'll dabble here and dabble there. Is it him or not? Verse 3 in Matthew 24. Now, as he sat on the Mount of Olives, the disciples came to him privately, saying, tell us, when will these things be, and what is the sign of your coming and the end of the age? Those questions that were waiting to be answered. The disciples want to know. They're filled with questions they have for Jesus. This is a good thing. They wanted to know Jesus' thoughts. They wanted him to inform them of what was going to happen. Wanting to know the mind of Christ should be on the forefront of our minds. We should wonder about what he thinks, ponder what he says, ask questions to find out answers. If we have a curious mind like this, we will seek after the things of God and discover things about him we never knew, and it never ends. On the other hand, if you're not curious about finding out about what Jesus thinks, be careful. A mind that doesn't inquire about the things of God becomes lax, disinterested, apathetic, and even uncaring about the things of God. Their attendance starts to drop. Their Bible reading starts to drop. And they just kind of get swallowed up by the things of the world. It's like, come on, wake up, family. One of my favorite verses, Psalm 27:4. One thing I have desired of the Lord, that will I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord, the beauty of the Lord, and to inquire in his temple. So it's being with God, seeing who he is, and then asking questions, inquiring, what are you all about, Lord? Show me more about you. Point one was Jesus knows your heart. Point two, Jesus knows your future. Point three, keep inquiring about Jesus. Keep asking those questions. You could do that here, after church, at any one of our studies, at any one of our life groups. That's why those things are there, to stir you up, to inquire more about the Lord. The questions we ask is so that you'll be like, oh, seeking answers. I want to know, Lord. I want to know. In the Bible, there's several places that say, he who has an ear, let him hear. He who has an ear, let him hear. At home, we have this dog named Clinch. Don't ask. He's a year and a half year old puppy. He's all energy and no brains. He's like 60-something pounds. If food comes into the picture, he does not think anything but food, even if it's your food. He's very good sometimes, and other times, he's not. And when he's not, I'll grab a hold of his ears gently. Don't come after me, PETA. I'll say, sometimes, Clint, you just don't listen, so I'm going to take off your ears. No, I haven't. He still has them. He's fine. The point is, he has ears, but he doesn't hear what's being said. He's distracted by food, which happens. I get it. But family, are you using your ears? You hear what's being said, but are you listening? Am I listening? We should be listening to what we hear so that we can act upon it, follow after God closer. If you're coming to church or reading the Word and you're not moved by either of them, be careful. The Word of God should move us, should enlighten us, should lift our spirits. It convicts us, no doubt, because we need that. But it's written to inspire us, train us, and grow us up. Without it, we're kind of stuck. On Saturday night, our hearts should be looking forward to what the Holy Spirit's going to say on Sunday morning. On Wednesday, we should be thinking about, what's he going to say tonight? Wednesday service. I'm going to men's study. What are they going to say tonight? In my personal study, what is he going to tell me today? Whenever. As I'm listening to the radio, some preacher guy on there, wow, what's he going to say today? It's the Word of God that is valuable. Amen. We should all have an expectation and an anticipation of learning something new about the Lord, which also reveals things about ourselves. And that's a good thing. One of my favorite verses will be up here, 2 Timothy 3:16. All Scripture, the whole Bible, is given by inspiration of God. He spoke it out. It's profitable. It benefits us for doctrine, what we should believe, for reproof, that's the conviction of the Holy Spirit, for correction, correcting our path, for instruction in righteousness, being trained up to stand right before God. Why? That the man of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work. The Word completes us. Our spouse doesn't, sorry. I know it's popular. You complete me. Well, you add to my life definitely, because I need my wife. She's great. But the Word of God completes us. Because it shows us what to believe. It convicts us. It corrects us. And now we're going to walk right in front of God. For every good work, there are works in front of us to do, family. Before you were ever born, God designed special works for you to figure out and to walk in, for you, all of us. God uses his Word to change us. Why should we listen to what God says? Isaiah 55, 8 and 9 says this, "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor my ways, nor your ways, my ways, says the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts." We know poquito, and God knows everything, even how many hairs are on your head. Spend all day trying to count it, you're going to mess up and start over. Some of you may not have the long count, but there's still stuff. But he knows everything. He knows how many molecules are in this podium. Wow. Any of you know? The Father knows everything, every concept, every truth, because He is truth. If we read what He says, we can learn more about Him. And if we don't read what He says and abide by it, we're going to flounder. The disciples here in Matthew 24 want to know what Jesus thinks. And in verse 4, He says, "And Jesus answered and said to them, 'Take heed that no one deceives you. For many will come in my name, saying, I am the Christ, and will deceive many.'" This is a warning from Jesus to take heed, to pay attention, to be careful, because deception is nothing new. You ever see an advertisement? Didn't come true? You see the burger? Oh, look, it's this big and wide, and you get it, and it's smashed, and what the heck? Deception's nothing new. Eve was deceived in the garden. Jim Jones deceived the People's Temple, leading to 909 deaths. David Koresh deceived the Branch Davidians, professing himself to be the spiritual descendant of King David, a messianic figure carrying out a divinely commissioned errand, which led to 79 people dying. Now, these are extreme examples of deception, but there are other forms that are more subtle. When someone knocks on your door and they smile and they're friendly and they genuinely believe what they say, but it can be another gospel. They may not believe that Jesus is God. There's a problem. They may believe that one day they're going to get their own planet. I see planets are spoken into existence, but I don't see me receiving one of them. They think that they have a special truth that no one else has but them. Be careful. It's another gospel. Turn to 2 Corinthians 11, please. It's to your right. There's Bibles in front of you if you don't have one. 2 Corinthians 11. This is Paul. He's concerned about the church in Corinthians, in Corinth. He's worried about deception in the church. And it says this, "Oh, that you would bear with me in a little folly, and indeed you do bear with me. For I am jealous for you with a godly jealousy. For I betrothed you to one husband that I may present you as a chaste virgin to Christ." So it's this imagery of the church being the bride of Christ. He's raised up this church and he's jealous for them because he wants good things for them. Verse 3, "But I fear lest somehow, as the serpent deceived Eve by his craftiness, so your minds may be corrupted from the simplicity that is in Christ." Corrupted from the simplicity that is in Christ. "For if he who comes preaches another Jesus, whom we have not preached, or if you receive a different spirit which you have not received, or if a different gospel which you have not accepted," excuse me, "you may well put up with it." He's worried that someone's going to come knock on their door. They're going to say something, and everyone's going to go, "Oh, that sounds good," when it's another gospel. He doesn't want them corrupted from the simplicity that is Christ. What is that simplicity? Jesus came in human form, God in human form, lived a life, died on a cross, rose again, ascended to heaven, that we might be saved from our sins. That simple. He calls us to love one another, bear one another's burdens, pray for one another, grow together, and then go to heaven. That simple. Jesus knows our heart. He knows our future. We're to keep inquiring about him. And point 4, the word corrects deception. The word corrects deception. The simplicity of Christ, what a beautiful phrase. So how do we know if it's another gospel? How do you know if it's false? By knowing the truth spoken in the word. If you know the word, when something false comes up, you're going to go, "Uh-uh. I don't see that here. Show me." You want to take what they say at your door, in the pamphlets you see, in anything someone tells you about Jesus, including me or Pastor Henry or Pastor Jim or Pastor William, anybody. If we say something about the Lord, look it up. And ask yourself, is what they're telling me what God is saying? Acts 17 says this, "But then the brethren immediately sent Paul and Silas away by night to Berea, and when they arrived, they went into the synagogue of the Jews." I love that. They go into the synagogue. "These were more fair-minded than those in Thessalonica, In that, here's the big part, they receive the word with all readiness and search the scriptures daily to find out whether these things were so. Therefore, many of them believed, and also not a few of the Greeks, prominent women as well as men. They searched the scriptures daily to find out whether these things were so. If we search the scriptures once a month, it's not going to help us a whole lot. If we're searching it daily, and we miss days, but if it's in our heart and mind and it's constantly there churning up, it's just a part of us. So a question for us, when was the last time you heard something about the scripture and in response, you went to see if these things were true? Or did you just assume it was correct? Now, nobody can tame the tongue. So there's times we speak up here and we're trying to say something from here to here and it doesn't come out right. But what's the essence of what we're saying? Does it align with this? And if it don't, come say something. We want to be correct. Matthew 24, verse 6, back to Matthew. And you will hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that you're not troubled, for all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. For nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom, and there will be famines, pestilences, and earthquakes in various places. All of these are the beginning of sorrows. Do we see any of this taking place today? Wars and rumors of wars, right? Yeah. Are we called to be paralyzed in fear over what is taking place? No, it says, see that you are not troubled. Don't be troubled about it. Why? Because it says, for these things must come to pass. It's part of God's plan for mankind. He's allowing these things to happen on purpose to come to the end of the age, the end of this planet, the end of his plan of salvation. It's going to happen. Are we near the end now, today? Are we in the last days now? It says, but the end is not yet. I do have pastor friends who say we are, that we're in the last days. I know that we're close to the last days. We could be in them. We could be just going to come into them. But these are the sorrows that we see as well. These are the beginning of sorrows. As Christians, we're called to abide in Christ, correct? To stay close to him. Does it matter if we're in the last days or not? No. For abiding and we're not, good. For abiding and we're in, good. We're to abide in Christ. Do we have any control from stopping some of these things? No. Then they will deliver you up to tribulation, verse 9, and kill you, and you will be hated by all nations for my name's sake. And then many will be offended, will betray one another, will hate one another. Then many false prophets will rise up and deceive many. And because lawlessness will abound, the love of many will grow cold. What part of this can you and I control? Can we stop wars? Can we prevent nations from rising against nations? Anyone stop a famine lately? Or pestilence? Or earthquakes? Anyone stop an earthquake? I'd like to see that. Can we prevent false prophets from coming on the scene and spouting out non-biblical nonsense? No, it was happening back then. It happens today as well. It's going to happen and is happening today, and we can't control these things. But what can we control? We can control that we're not troubled. We can control that to keep our love from growing cold. Don't be troubled by it, and don't let your love grow cold. How, you may think? You don't know all the sorrow and headache and heartache I've experienced in life, the pain, the disappointment, so I'm so troubled. True, but you can control that too. Go to Philippians 4. This is how you control heartache, being troubled, and your love from growing cold. Philippians 4, verse 4. I love these verses. I use them frequently because they help me. I want them to help everybody. Verse 4 says, rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice. Amen? What does rejoice mean? Celebrate. We're going to celebrate in the Lord. When do we do it?
Always.
Always. Oh, even when there's earthquakes and pestilence? Oh, okay. Let your gentleness be made known to all men. The Lord is at hand. So our reputation should be one of gentleness. If you walk into a room, are people afraid of what your reaction is going to be? Or are they soothed by your presence in their lives? In verse 6, be anxious for everything? Nothing. Well, how can that be? Be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your heart and mind in Christ Jesus. That's a promise. If you actually give, if you rejoice in Him, your gentle soul, you're giving Him all of your prayers, He guards this, that's a promise. If you're anxious about anything, you haven't prayed over it enough. But when you do, thank you, Lord, for taking away my worry about pestilence or earthquakes or my job or my kids or my dog that doesn't listen. Thank you, Lord, that you're going to handle that and I can have peace. Verse 8, it's so simple. This is part of the simplicity of Christ. It's so simple. Verse 8, finally, brethren, whatever things are true, whatever things are noble, whatever things are just, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are of good report, if there's any virtue, if there's anything praiseworthy, meditate on these things. Where does it say meditate on earthquakes and pestilences? No, the true, the noble, the just, the pure, the lovely, the good report, the virtuous, the praiseworthy. If I'm constantly thinking about these things, guess what happens to this and this? He's guarding my heart and mind in Christ Jesus. I'm a gentle soul. Now I'm praising Him all the time for who He is and what He's done. Living a lifestyle, Philippians 4, controls the brain and the heart, and we can see situations with godly eyes. And now instead of stirring things up, we can be a calming presence to someone who's all stirred up. And when someone is all stirred up, brothers and sisters, you know why they're stirred up? Because they haven't been in Philippians 4 lately or being transformed by the Word lately. We all have our moments. But this is what changes us, family. It changes us. Isaiah 26:3 says, you will keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on you because he trusts in you. So I'm praising him. He's guarding me. I'm in perfect peace because my mind is on him. All these simple things connect. Another one of my favorite verses, 2 Timothy 1:7. For God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. That's what he's given us. Back to verse 13, Matthew 24. It says this, but he who endures to the end shall be saved. And this gospel of the kingdom will be preached in all the world as a witness to all nations. And then the end will come. So Jesus knows our heart, our future. We should inquire about him. The word corrects deception. And point 5, be a part of God's plan for mankind. Be a part of God's plan for mankind. We have to be careful not to think that since we're saved and we're going to heaven that we can sit back, because what happens is we can develop an attitude like the scribes and Pharisees had. I'm good to go. Everything's fine with me. I don't have to worry about y'all. There's an easy way to get complacent. It'd be easy to think you deserve your salvation. After all, look how good you are. Oh, filthy rags. Maybe you even pray and read, pay your tithe, come to church events. You can still develop this apathetic attitude. I do my stuff. What's the matter with y'all? Be careful not to think of the church as some sort of country club as an additional source of comfort to your already comfortable life. When was the goal of life to have a comfortable life? If your life is completely comfortable, how much are you striving for the sake of the gospel? Be careful not to think we deserve this. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Me too. out in the world, there are trans kids, trans adults, drug addicts, homeless men and women, convicts, homosexuals, gossips, thieves, prideful, and more, who all need Jesus too. We're no better than they are. God desires that all would come to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, not just the good people. The derelicts, the unworthy, the misfits, even tax collectors, prostitutes, and sinners. God would want them all to know Jesus, to repent and be saved. They're out there, and they're also in here. Here we are. The Lord wants all of us to surrender to him. So be careful not to think you're good to go because you're so good, but you fail in the weightier matters of justice, mercy, and faith. Let's turn to Acts chapter 8. Turn to Acts chapter 8, please. We're almost there. Thanks for journeying with me. I love hearing pages turn. That means you're searching the scriptures. Acts chapter 8, verse 26. Now an angel of the Lord spoke to Philip, saying, "Arise and go towards the south along the road which goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza." Ever heard of that place? This is desert. So he arose and went, and behold, a man of Ethiopia, a eunuch of great authority under Candace, the queen of the Ethiopians, who had charge of all her treasury and had come to Jerusalem to worship, was returning. And sitting in his chariot, he was reading Isaiah the prophet. Then the Spirit said to Philip, "Go near and overtake this chariot." So Philip ran to him and heard him reading the prophet Isaiah and said, "Do you understand what you're reading?" And he said, "How can I unless someone guides me?" And he asked Philip to come up and sit with him. The place in the scripture which he read was this: "He was led as a sheep to the slaughter, and as a lamb before his shearer is silent, so he opened not his mouth. In his humiliation, his justice was taken away, and who will declare his generation? For his life is taken from the earth." What's that prophecy speaking of? Jesus. So the eunuch answered Philip and said, "I ask of you, of whom does this prophet say this, of himself or of some other man?" Then Philip opened his mouth, beginning at this scripture, preach Jesus to him. That was the proper response. Now, as they went down at the road, they came to some water, and the eunuch said, "See, here is water. What hinders me from being baptized?" Then Philip said, "If you believe with all your heart, you may." And he answered and said, "I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God." So he commanded the chariot to stand still. And both Philip and the eunuch went down into the water, and he was baptized. Then when they came up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord caught Philip away so that the eunuch saw him no more, and he went on his way rejoicing. Excuse me. But Philip was found in Astotis, and passing through, he preached in all the cities till he came to Caesarea. So here we have Philip meeting this Ethiopian eunuch. Did he have that planned ahead of time? No? It's an unscheduled event, but God had scheduled this meeting with the eunuch from Ethiopia to meet Philip and come to salvation in Christ. God knew, Philip didn't. But Philip was ready and available to be used by God in an unusual manner. What if Philip wasn't willing? What if he felt it inconvenient to go up to this guy? What if he didn't feel like running? What if he wasn't bold to ask the question, "Do you understand what you're reading?" What if he didn't preach Jesus to this man? Now, God has his ways, of course, and this man would have come to faith some other way. But Philip was the one God used. He was ready, willing, and able to do as the angel of the Lord spoke to him. So as 2023 comes to an end, I'm wondering how many unusual encounters God has scheduled for us, church family. for us sitting here and online. I wonder just how many people will come to salvation because the people of CCB were ready, willing, and able to preach the gospel of Christ to a stranger. I can't wait to fill up this seat and that seat and that seat and that seat and go, oh, hey, that's the guy who fixed my flat and I told him about Jesus. And that's the lady at the laundromat. And that's the one at Walmart. Oh, and that's that Mormon friend of mine who's searching the scriptures now. I wonder how many are going to come in 2024. Did you know it's not up to me and Pastor Henry, Pastor Jim, Pastor William to do all that work? No. You guys are going to have encounters we'll never have. And that's the beauty of it. You're all going to go out. You're going to preach Jesus to people who need him. At a minimum, hey, why don't you come to church with us? There's this pastor man who's going to scream at you all day. Come on out. It's going to be fun. But he's going to tell you about Jesus. So as 2023 comes to a close, let's remove any ungodly attitudes. Let's seek the Lord's face more often. Let's keep growing individually and as a church body. So we're going to do an exercise right now. Everyone, look at somebody else you don't know. Make eye contact. Look at someone you don't know, make eye contact. I know. It's uncomfortable. It's going to be all right. It's going to be okay. Just look. It's like, oh no, I've been sitting next to them for an hour, and now I got to look at them. Think of it, a bunch of flawed individuals sitting around you, you included, coming here to praise the Lord and hear about him. Isn't that awesome? Why in the world would we be here together? Because of the Lord. And as the worship team comes up, I have three take-home points. And then I'm going to have the offer of salvation to anyone who'd come to Jesus, or if you're far from him, come close to him. Return to him. Point one is trust the one who knows your heart. Trust the one who knows your heart. Point two is turn back to Jesus immediately. Turn back to Jesus immediately. And point three is this, look forward to his plan for you in 2024. Amen? Even the rest of today. Amen? So I'm going to pray, and if you want to receive Jesus Christ as your Savior, I'm going to pray. You just got to repeat after me. It's not a magical prayer, but it's your heart expressing what you would desire. And if you're far from him, maybe not so sharp with him right now, and you want to draw closer, pray as well. And then we're going to pray about what's going to happen in 2024. So let's pray. So, Father, we come in the name of Jesus. And, Lord, I admit that I'm a great sinner, but, Jesus, you're an even greater Savior. I confess right now that, Jesus, you are my Lord. I believe in my heart that God has raised you from the dead. I call upon your name to save me right now. Fill me with your Spirit and show me how to walk in your ways. In the name of Jesus, amen. And Lord, I'm far from you right now. I pray that you would draw me close and remind me of your goodness and grace in my life. That however 2023, whatever's gone on, Lord, that you would erase the bad parts, that I would invest myself more in the good parts this coming year. Help me to walk faithfully before you. And Lord, I pray for my church family, for anyone who's hurting, anyone who's sick, anyone lonely, anyone struggling. You'd fill them with your Spirit, give them joy and peace in Jesus. That as a church body, we would reach out to those who struggle, that we'd encourage them in Christ and bless them. Lord, you're so good to us. We praise your holy name. Thank you for your word. Thank you for this day. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. So, Father, we give you our worship right now. Give you our thanks. You're worthy to be praised. We love you. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Let's stand and worship the Lord. Thank you.
To receive Jesus, come on down now. There's people here to pray with you. If you need other prayer needs, come on down as well. God bless you.